Just a couple of seconds here. There it is.
Okay, I'd like to call to order the Weathersfield School Board meeting for February 8th at 6:02 PM. We'll start off with the Pledge Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. Next up is changes or additions to the agenda. I actually have one. I was contacted by a member of the community regarding spring musical. And so I wanted to add that, I guess, to items for discussion. Does anyone else have anything? It's not already on the agenda. Okay, hearing nothing, we'll move on to the approval of the minutes from January 11th. I read them over and I thought they looked pretty good. Does anyone want to make a motion to approve?
Mark will make that motion. Okay. To approve the minutes.
Do I have a second? Jamie?
I'll second that motion.
Okay, great. Are there any changes or any discussion? No? Okay. All in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain? No. Okay, I guess that's unanimous. Up next, public participation or announcements. Do we have anything? I don't think so. Okay. I guess we'll go on to our, and I keep meaning to change this, we should say lead learners report, right, Brian?
Yeah, we can. We can change that.
All right, let me get ready to present here. Ooh, it's not loading. Here we go for February 8th, 2022. So our lead learner report. So first off, we have Ms. Powers and Mrs. Robinson here from our kindergarten team, and they are here to talk about their annual project, and they made it virtual this year. And so I'm gonna go ahead and let them talk about their peace walk, and I will let them go take it away, and I will then, oops, sorry. Oh my good. Ah, I am having technical difficulties today. Hold on. Sorry. I tried to share it as a window and it wouldn't let me do it. Laura and Leanna are waiting patiently.
We do teach 5 and 6 year olds, so patience is kind of a thing.
You guys are used to it then with me, so. All right, hold on. Let me get back to you then.
You're muted, Brian.
That's probably on purpose.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Swearing at his computer.
Well, I have a little bit to speak about, so we could start there. Would that work for you? Yeah? Okay, let's do that. So I am Laura Powers, half of the kindergarten team.
And I'm Leanna Robinson, the other half.
The better half, we call her. So what we would like to share with you tonight is a video that was actually designed and created by Mrs. Robinson with a little help from our amazing tech team to add our music, which showcases our kindergarten students' ideas on changing the world. Due to the inflexibility of COVID safety protocols, we had to do something a little different this year than what we've done in years past. Instead of creating a video, what we normally do is we have what we like to call a peace walk. The students line up with their written messages on signs. We walk throughout the building, in and out of classrooms, the ones that agree to have us. And we silently share our ideas. And yes, you would be amazed at how silent a 5 and 6-year-old can be. They are very silent during this time. Although we clearly tie this activity into our curriculum, the focus that we create here continues throughout the school year. Our students learn some pretty big concepts based on our adopted portrait of a graduate competencies. So in kindergarten, we've already worked on communication at the beginning of the school year. We've worked now for several weeks on the concept of perseverance. And we're now introducing the concept of integrity. And yep, our kids actually know those big words and what they mean, and they use them. We created this special activity around Martin Luther King Jr. Day for a few reasons. One, we try hard to teach our students about diversity, equality, and celebrating our differences in a way that's relevant to kindergartners. Two, we're adamant about teaching our students that change can happen in the world. Sorry, the dog. Without violence or negativity, even when faced with adversity. And three, it's our hope that teaching our students about historical moments where we've learned from our mistakes and how not to repeat those mistakes will create strong future leaders and change makers. We've all seen how much things can change, obviously, and they have, but we still need to be progressive in our change. And we feel it's important to plant the seeds now because these little ones will be the ones that are going to make those changes. So you'll often hear us say to our students, use your words, not your hands. And so without further ado, this, if Mr. Martis is ready, is the kindergarten's view on how words can change the world. We hope you enjoy. There is music.
Minor difficulty. We'll figure it out here. Act two.
Do you want me to say the whole thing over again? I could just start from the beginning. No, you're good. Okay. With the barking dog included.
Still having trouble, Brian?
Do you want me to try to see if I can share it on my screen?
I have it ready to go. It's just I tried to present it a different way and it's not doing it. So give me just one more second. I apologize. I have my expert tech team here. So give me just a second. I apologize.
I can change the world with my own two hands, make it a better place with my own two hands, make it a kinder place with my own two hands, with my own, with my own. I can make peace on earth with my own two hands. I can clean up the earth with my own two hands. I can reach out to you with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a brighter place with my own two hands. I'm gonna make it a safer place with my own two hands. I'm gonna help the human race with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. With my own, with my own two hands. I can hold you in my own two hands, and I can comfort you with my own two hands. But you got to use your own two hands, use your own two hands, use your own two hands, with our own.
Very good. Thank you.
And it's okay if you cried. I cry every time I watch it.
They're all so BJ, smart and so wise.
BJ, every time, right? Every time we walk around the building, we cry.
Nice job. Thank you very much for sharing, Leanna and Laura. We appreciate it. That was amazing. All right. Let me go ahead and go back to my presentation. And actually, we have another group that's going to be participating or presenting today, and it is our amazing eighth graders. They are sharing a business plan with us. So I'm going to let Mr. Vila and Mr. Santangelo, they didn't know they were going to talk, but I'm putting them on the spot because I like to do that sometimes. I'm going to go ahead and let them share the information about, have them lead off with the project, and then we'll have the students get on there and share. Okay. So Mr. Vila or Mr. Santangelo, whoever wants to speak.
Well, I can start while Ryan gets his paperwork together. For your information, Mr. Santangelo and I are working together on an economic and engineering activity for the class in an effort to have our student learning mirror real life experiences. In essence, the students are split into seven groups or businesses that are tasked with creating new spirit wear for Wethersfield School. And each individual business will design, advertise, and create a t-shirt or hoodie of their own and display it within our school. It is hoped this will generate orders and that the pupils with Ms. Jarvis's expertise will silkscreen these garments. My suggestion was that any monies generated by this endeavor can be directed at least in part to the eighth grade class for some sort of end of the school year activity. However, many of the student businesses are donating at least a portion of their sales or proposed sales to local charities. It is our understanding that in order to move forward, this is going to require permission from the board. And at Mr. Martez's suggestion, some of the students were asked if they would present some of their ideas and perhaps part of their business plan at the board meeting tonight. It is short notice, as Mr. Santangelo had said, for them to actually develop their full business plan that they have been working on economics class in such short notice, but they do have some things they would like to share about what they're doing and how they're doing it. And we have an order. I believe Ryan, are you there or?
Yep, I'm here. Go ahead and our first student.
Our first, Madeline Richardson, I believe, was going to share some of her information.
So I'm going to stop sharing and then we'll let Madeline, if she wants to share anything else, and share from there, okay?
Hi, I'm Madeline. My business partners are Allie Leary and Madison McDonald. Our company, Just For You, designs and markets spirit wear for middle school students who want a special way to display their school pride. Our product is of the highest quality, gilded and cotton that won't shrink, competitively priced and available in a t-shirt or hoodie. A sample of our product line entitled Mountain View can be found in Wethersfield School. Just look for the name Just For You next to the entrance of the stairwell. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you very much, Madeline. All right, next.
Who was next on that on your proposal? Was it
Gabby? Crane. Yeah, Gabrielle Crane.
Gabrielle Crane here. I saw a number of students here.
Hello, my name is Gabrielle Crane. My business partners are Kenzie Westcott, Kimari Wild Goose, and Liliana Keefe. Our company, Iron Designs, designs and markets comfortable, high-quality attire for aspiring young adults who want to display their school pride. Our product is of the highest quality, competitively priced, and available in a t-shirt or hoodie. Our spirit wear is targeted mostly at fifth grade through eighth grade or older. A sample of our product line entitled 2022 Starry Panther can be found. Just look for the name Iron Designs in the kitchen at Wethersfield School. Thank you.
They have all carved out prime advertising space within our school. Location one would be for their spirit wear, and location two is for their advertising posters. I think Bailey Athorn. Bailey?
Yep, Bailey's up next.
Hi, I'm Bailey Athorn. The plan was for Daxton to read it, but I guess I'm going to read it. So here it goes. Hello, my name is Bailey Athorn. My business partners are Daxton Redmond, Anna Bergeron, and Samantha Marsh. Our company, Reverse Apparel, designs and markets inclusive clothing for upper-level students and staff. People who want a minimalistic and clean way to display their school pride should shop with us. Our product is very high-end quality and available in a t-shirt or a hoodie. Our sample of our product will be available at Wethersfield School. Just look for the name Reversed Apparel next to the office in the front lobby and in the back stairwell. Thank you.
Was it Angie? I believe Angelina Neal.
Hi, my name is Angie Neal, and my business partners are Cameron Schultz Courier and Justin Roy. Our company, JAC, is designing and marketing unique t-shirt designs. Our designs create spirit wear for students who want an eye-catching look or just a cool way to display their school pride. Our products are high quality, well-priced, and available on a t-shirt. A sample of our product, which is named PAW, will be found in Weathersfield School. Just look for the name JAC on a poster located on the wall straight ahead when you walk into school. Thank you. Next, I believe my friend and classmate Kaylee will be presenting.
Is she here? Perhaps not. Perhaps she's not here yet. But we can move on, I believe.
Next, we have Justin.
Any questions by the board on the endeavor or the project or?
Anne-Marie, you're muted.
I was trying to tell you, but I was too.
I'm curious to know how much they're planning to charge for the t-shirts and sweatshirts. Or is it individual between the groups?
Well, they all have different designs. And so what we're finding out, based on one color, two color, front, back, the cost will vary. They should have the final costs from our printer tonight. And so they're going to mark them up accordingly. They do not all need to sell their product at the same price. They're all different. They're all unique. I've got a couple of orders in already.
Do they have the designs done already? Like, could we see the designs or no?
I have them. They've all emailed them to me. I'd be glad to send them to you at some point. I could do this after I'm off, I think. What they're discovering is that, you know, based on your cost, your selling price will change. And not all things are the same. You have to compare apples and oranges.
Mark, do you have your hand up?
I was going to ask what you just asked, and is it a possibility of having that sent out as an email blast to the board members?
I'm sure someone will be able to do that. And I will locate someone to do that for me, yes.
Okay. Bailey has her hand up.
I could show you one of the designs. I could show you my design at the moment. I don't have anybody else's, but I could at least show you mine.
Okay. We lost you, Bailey.
Yeah, it's not letting me share it.
Oh.
I don't
know.
But
we'll get it emailed to us. Thank you, though. Jackie? Or Ryan?
Yeah, we were toying with the idea of having them make a make and design a website to sell them as well. So that might be another way you can see what they're working on.
Cool. Jackie?
I'm just kind of curious about the mechanics behind it. Like, how long have you been working on this? And, you know, is this a semester-long project? Is it a few weeks? I saw at first, like, the business presentation, the business plan presentation. Are we going to see that as well tonight?
I think they mentioned that they didn't have time to do a full business plan presentation tonight, but right. just sort of these short ones tonight.
Yeah, we've started the project, I believe, last Tuesday. Week ago Tuesday. So the wow, kids
will work on this
for, let's see, for six days or so. So when we realized we had the meeting this coming Tuesday, the class had only been working on this for 3 days, so they really hadn't had time to present it. Mr. Santangelo hadn't recovered all of that necessary for them to submit a formal business plan, and we're still gathering some of our information, like the cost of the t-shirts and how we're going to have that done and the logistics of it. It's a brand new unit. We've never done it before. And Mr. Martez has given us the freedom to run with it. And the class
are you just looking for board approval to sell the t-shirts, or is that
basically, if I understand right, that's kind of what was necessary for this mm-hmm. to move forward.
I think that you guys have done a great job in that short period of time. So thank you for presenting even what you did. And I would certainly welcome you back to show us some of your business plans when they are done. I think it'd be great. Thank you.
I saw Allison Leary had her hand up, but then she put it down. Did you want to speak or?
Yeah, I messaged Kaylee and she said that her Chromebook isn't working right now and it won't turn on for her to get into the meeting.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Mark?
Do we need a motion to approve Mr. Vila and Mr. Santangelo to administer this as a fundraiser?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay, so moved.
Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Jackie. We'll can do a roll call. Is Kristen on yet or not? Let's see if she's here. No, I don't think so. Okay. So first, we'll start off with Jamie.
Aye.
Jackie.
Aye.
Mark.
Aye.
And myself, aye. That's unanimous. Thanks, guys. And good luck with your sales. Hope you all do great. Thank you.
And then we can
thank you very much. Appreciate your time.
And we can plan to have them back next month and do a more detailed business plan.
Great.
And move forward with it. Thank you.
Do you have more, Brian?
Yes, of course I have more. All right, so the next part is just to give you guys the update on Leader in Me. Why is that not? Hopefully. Hold on. I am having technical issues like crazy today.
You better get that tech consultant back.
I know, huh? I think he went to go finish his math homework.
Oh, yeah. That's not right.
He got tired of dealing with Dad. All right, there we go. I think I've got it. All right, so Ms. Cole has been working on her SEL lessons using Leader in Me lessons, just like she's normally been doing. She's been working on habits 3 and 4. And then I know I gave you a little startup way back when of a song that Mr. Shambo was working on for our 7 habits. Well, he did a complete new one. Instead of doing each habit separately, he did it so that all 7 habits are on one. So I won't play it right now just for the sake of time, but when I share my presentation with you, you'll be able to hear the song at your leisure. We did share it out with all the teachers, and I do hear some kids starting to sing it. Enrollment and attendance for January 12th through February 8th. So our total enrollment, we're up to 238 students. Our average daily attendance is up from last month. Last month we were at 86, now we're at almost 91%. And we did have one new student this month in second grade. COVID updates, multiple classes have been affected. We've been doing a test at home to keep children at school. We do send out a robocall. Some of you who are parents might have gotten those robocalls, and emails go out to families talking about our what the procedures are. The test at home does work very well. Kids who are already vaccinated just test days 4 and 5. Kids that are unvaccinated, they test all 5 days. But as long as students are coming up negative, they are able to stay at school and participate. And again, I'd like to give a special recognition out to Emily Stevens, our nurse, and our COVID task force to be there to be able to help us out, because it is constantly changing. And Emily is able to keep up on all of that and do an amazing job with keeping our communities safe. Building community, continuing our monthly conversations with Chief Spaulding regarding fire safety. It was nice to have a little longer conversation with him this month because we were at the vaccination clinic together on January 22nd, along with the Rescue Inc. out of Brattleboro. We had 75 people that vaccinations were administered, and we're doing a follow-up clinic on the 19th for people that need their second shot, or if people were unable to get out there for the initial vaccination clinic. Communicating with town manager Brandon Gulnick regarding our town report, which is the town report is going to be a virtual meeting, and we're having the hybrid model for our actual school report on that day. We finished up our service award, super excited about that, to give that out at our town meeting on February 26th. And then last night we did have our first basketball game with spectators at Weathersfield. We played Chester. Our boys fought a hard fight, but it ended up coming up a little short in the end. But then our girls came through and ended up winning last night. So it was exciting to see the kids being able to play basketball and also to have fans there. We had lots of smiling faces on parents from both sides of the court. So it was nice to see families there. And for me, it was the first time we've really had any families on campus since I've been there. So it was pretty amazing. So good job, Weathersfield students. And our basketball players, and I know they have a game today, a 3-4 game today, and then they're at it again on Friday with a couple of games at home. All right, so exact path at Weathersfield. So here's some of our data. So I'm big on showing up data and showing what we're working on. And so this is our Weathersfield reading diagnostic from the last one. So, and I like to compare of where we're at and what we're doing. And just a shout out to our amazing teachers and what a great job they're doing. So right here, we have in, and then I'll show you the difference between our first diagnostic and the second diagnostic. So as a whole, we had 14% of our students that were in the red in grades K through 8, compared to the supervisory union that had 29% as a whole, the rest of the supervisory union. And then in the orange level, which is the 25th through 49th percentile, we had 41 compared to the SU's 33. So looking at that number, you're saying, they go, well, 41, that's a little higher because we want the orange and the red to be lower. But if you look at, you'll see in the next, or in the slides when I show the comparison of the first diagnostic compared to the second diagnosis, how many students we moved actually from the red to the orange and then from the orange to the green and so on. And then we had 23% of our students in reading in green and then 22% in blue. Similar for language arts. I'll let you guys take a look at that. And then if you look at math as well. So our students and our staff are rocking it on the exact path, which is nice. So it gives a good indication of where students are at right now. And then if you go in here to our trends, so this is for reading, and you can look at the first diagnostic, which we tested 221 students. The second diagnostic, we tested 231 students. And we went from 29% in the red to 15%, 38 to 41, 20 to 23, and 12 to 22. So you see the jumps in where students went from red down to orange and then moving up in the blue tier. And that's where we want students. We want students in the green and the blue. And then we have similar results for language arts. from 30 to 13, a lot of growth there. 18 to 28, a lot of growth there. And then again in math. So some huge growth there. So it just shows that even with a pandemic going, our students are still getting a lot of academics and are doing a fantastic job. Thank you, teachers. Thank you, students, for keeping up the great work that you're doing.
Brian, what was the date for the first test versus the second testing?
The first test was right around in October. I don't know the exact date. And then we just finished up with our second diagnostic the end of January.
Well, that's great progress. Congratulations to the students and staff.
Yep, they're doing a fantastic job. Any other questions on that? All right. Already talked about the vaccination clinic. And then we have the follow-up clinic on February 19th. Again, staff recognition, just a shout out to our staff. They're doing a fantastic job. We do have a very dedicated staff at Weathersfield, our support staff, our professional staff. Everybody has just been working extra, extra hard. And so we appreciate that. They put in long hours, they work hard, and they're making sure, obviously, from looking at the diagnostics of that our students are getting what they need. So I appreciate that. And so just wanted to give a shout out to our entire staff. Keep up the amazing work that you guys are doing. We appreciate you. Timeline as far as mission, vision, core values. Still waiting to get student input. It's been a little tough the last few days to try to get, the goal was to have it in January. We did meet January with the community at one of our coffee talks with the lead learner and got some community input on what the staff had already worked on. But trying to get the students together in between, keeping them separated from pods and all that stuff. So we're still working on getting that final information for it. So I hope to have information soon, but it's been a little bit more challenging with COVID. To be able to get that information. So we're still working on that to come up with the correct mission, vision, and core values for our school. Upcoming events, virtual coffee with Lead Learner is tomorrow at 9 o'clock. Winter break is coming up February 14th through February 18th. I know everybody's excited for that, to be able to get some time off, some much deserved time off. And then when we come back on February 25th, we do have our early release day. We also have NAEP testing for fourth and eighth grade students. And that is coming up February 23rd and 24th. The fourth grade will test on the 23rd, eighth grade will test on the 24th. And then we have our town meeting on Saturday, February 26th. And then town voting coming up on Tuesday, March 1st. And that is it for me.
Remember to turn my mic back on. Thank you, Brian. Appreciate it. Does anyone have any questions for Lead Learner Martis? Mark?
Yeah, I was just curious, as far as the attendance for the basketball game, what was that like and what protocols were in place as far as masking, vaccination requirements, or grouping as far as families?
Okay, so what we did is I got to be the bouncer on last night, which was fun. So I was at the door to greet all of our families. And what we did is, as long as parents everybody had a mask on that came in, they were allowed two spectators per player. They sat as families and spaced themselves apart. Everybody kept their masks on, and everybody was just really excited to be there. And it was a great time for everybody that was there. So
very good to hear. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much. I guess we'll move on to the superintendent report.
Yeah, I will share my screen. It's always tough following that act with all the kids, and Brian, mine won't be anywhere near as exciting, but I'll try to get through it. Let's go up here, and I assume everybody can see that. We could do questions at the end like we did with Brian. I mean, I'm certainly more than willing to stop if somebody has a pressing question. And Brian covered a lot of this, right? The families are continuing to cooperate according to the protocol. They're really doing a great job keeping kids in school. We're still going through about 800 tests a week across the SU. The state, luckily, is providing those tests, so we don't have to pay for them, but we do have to distribute them, and that sometimes is a little bit of a challenge. But again, our nurses and staff are doing a great job. Brian talked about the partnership there with the Scutney Fire Department, Chief Spaulding. That went incredibly well. And the follow-up, as Brian said, is on the 19th. There are still concerns every day, you know, in all of our buildings about the ability to staff a building on any particular day. But our support staff and teachers have been so generous with, you know, doing jobs that, you know, and again, we try to give small remuneration when we can, but you know, if somebody has to cover a class or miss a planning period, or a support staff member has to take a class, or quite frankly, an administrator has to take a class, we all just pitch in. And I think it's a tribute to the staff and to the administrative team and to the support staff that we haven't had to close a building yet for COVID reasons. And I think it's also one of the reasons why, you know, you can see even in the middle of a pandemic, those exact path scores, again, we wish it could be even better, but you know, that you could see the success rate. We meet about weekly with the COVID task force, which is made up of administrators, some Mount Scutney hospital reps and the nurses, just about every week, not always every week, but we probably will be meeting either right before or right after the vacation to talk about, you know, other potential loosening of restrictions. I mean, you're probably hearing on a national level now, we've had probably 2 or 3 days of the lowest case rate really ever in Vermont. I mean, even back to when we were pre-holiday, which is good. I don't mean outrageous potential loosening of restrictions, but I just think about, you know, getting more kids together, you know, the theater. I know later on, Anne Marie, you want to talk about theater, or somebody had a question about theater, which would mean crossing pods again, and those kinds of things. You know, we did loosen up the spectator restrictions. So we take a look at it, you know, as often as we can. And I think there's a sense that, you know, I know that term gets overused, but the new normal, but you know, the sooner we can get our schools and our kids back to feeling like, you know, like the new normal, the better off I think we're gonna be. Other general updates, budgets are all adopted. The warnings are posted. Brian kind of gave the dates. We're gonna be meeting that Saturday at 10 a.m. in the morning and presenting our budget. We'll talk about that later. Subdegree temperatures do make the morning delay call a tough one. I remember one superintendent, a New England superintendent, said when asked what would be the thing he's going to miss least when he retires, and he said delaying school or calling a cancellation day, because it's always tough. But luckily, it's a good partnership with our road crews, and Jim Taft gets up and rides those roads in the morning. We were wondering about this morning because there was some talk about freezing temperatures and freezing roads, but you know, we try to use the best information we've got and make that call. And you know, we're going to have those delayed starts. Maybe we're done, but I think people appreciated the good old-fashioned snow day on Friday. Brian already covered this. We finished up the second round of Exact Path and Track My Progress. I think the thing to remember as those kids are engaging in Exact Path, it is really new. I mean, there were some teachers who piloted it over last year, but really, across the SU, this is the first time kids are encountering it. And I know that one of the things that Angie and Brittany at the SU are going to do is they're going to be coming to the buildings and really trying to get some information from teachers and kids about how they felt about, you know, Exact Path. And I mean, a lot of times I think we feel like students are assessed maybe even a little too often. And I think the students may feel like that too, but we're going to get that feedback, and, you know, who knows, maybe if Exact Path works, we might drop Track My Progress. It looks like Exact Path is lining up better with SBAC scores, even though we don't have them yet. But, you know, from some of that preliminary data that is not public yet. It looks like it is going to be a good match. At the SU meeting, we're going to look deeper, much like Brian just did. We'll look deeper at more of the recovery data. I know that Brittany's working on that data dashboard, and we'll be talking more about that coming up on the 23rd. NAEP testing. Brian, you did NAEP testing, correct?
Yes, I did go over that 23rd and 24th of this month coming up. Information's already gone out to families.
All right, so that's good. And I know some of the schools have already finished. I know Windsor and Heartland, I think, are finishing up this week. But that is the National Assessment of Elementary Progress. Again, we don't get any local data on that, which is why administrators don't really love administering that. And again, it's another assessment our kids have to engage in. But Vermont gets Vermont data compared to national data. And Vermont has always done incredibly well on the NAEP, on the elementary test in grades 4 and 8. So I think that's why the Agency of Education likes to keep participating, because we tend to blow a lot of the other states out of the water. We're either in the top, I think one year we were in the top three. We certainly are in the top 5 to 7. So that's always good news. We are. I'll talk more about this at the SU meeting, so I won't spend a lot of time on it now, but we are finished. I'm just waiting on Springfield, because we're going to partner this with Springfield. The RFP from my end, I think it's done. We'll be sending that out to a variety of persons and companies to do an equity audit update. Obviously, it won't be in the next month or two. We need to let our schools and our staff kind of rest, but we're thinking if we could get the RFP out in the next month or so, and have sort of a target date of either June, or even begin some of the preliminary work over the summer, and get a baseline. You know, you saw that wonderful presentation by the kindergarten kids, but and that's the kind of stuff that they'll be looking at: library materials, curriculum, instruction, units, policies, procedures, just to see. And it'll be an equity audit, not just around race, but it'll be an equity audit around, you know, economic factors and special ed versus regular ed. All of that is around inclusion and equity. So stay tuned, because we're still on that, and we really want that baseline. Well-deserved vacation next week. So hats off. I agree with Brian. I love going to Weathersfield, and the staff is a great staff, and the kids are great. And I get to spend a little bit of time there last week. I'm going to be there again tomorrow. You should be very proud of the school, and everybody has a very deserved rest coming up next week. And depending on whether you talk to parents or staff, there's a little different level of enthusiasm and excitement about that vacation week. Next week. The middle level work continues. I want to hats off to Jay Villa and the whole middle school team. Jay is on part of the leadership team at the SU level. He's been helping out. I don't know if he's still on, but I want to thank him publicly for that work. We have finally, decided that we want to concentrate on grades 6, 7, and 8, which will not be a big change for Weathersfield. They are already doing grades 6, 7, and 8, and they're also doing great things. And you could see tonight that business plan project is an exact example of how kids like to engage in real world. We call it sometimes place based or project based learning, and I know that team has worked hard to make that happen. I have a second quarter financial update I'll give you after I stop sharing my screen here in just a second. I thought I could get it out to you over the weekend, but I'll send it out afterwards so you can look at it a little bit more closely. But it's still good news for our second quarter of this year. And last but not least, teacher negotiations. Thank Jackie Antonovich for the work that she put in with that team. It was a lot of work and a lot of nights and a lot of meetings in between meetings, but the teacher contract is not awaiting final signatures. It has all the necessary signatures. So we now have a master agreement, a 3-year master agreement. This year happens to be the first year, however, so we'll have 2 years after this year. And I know that both the board negotiators and the teacher negotiators are glad that we don't have to come back to the table next year. It's time consuming, and it's also trying, because it's, you know, you're just basically trying to come to some level of agreement and make it a win-win where possible. The support staff, Barb Thomas is working at Weathersfield this year. Barb and BJ and Kelly O'Brien were the support staff negotiators, and we finished that up last week. So we're now just reviewing the first draft of that document. But I want to thank again, it's the same team from the board, but I want to thank BJ and Barbara and Kelly for making that work. And I do think that the board tried to be as generous with support staff. We want to attract support staff. We want to keep support staff. And part of that is you have to pay support staff. So I think over the 3 years, and that's a 3-year contract too. It goes next year, the year after, and the year after that. So it goes from 22 through 25. So that was good work. And let me just quickly share. I probably didn't have to do that. I'm going to share the financials just quickly with you, just so you can see it. I assume everybody can see that, correct, Anne-Marie? I can't see you, that's why, but.
Yes, I can see it.
All right, great. So you see at the top the revenue, and we always anticipate all of the revenue coming in, and that's all of the state educational spending grant monies, and you can see it's quite a bit of money that gets budgeted, and we're anticipating we'll get all of it. So we're anticipating 100% of the revenues, and then if you go down, you'll see where we are with the expenditures, this is a little more difficult to project, but they're all pretty much on target. And I see that, you can see the available balance is there. Tuition and assessments always ends up being the big number. But if you get down to the bottom, if you take in all the revenue and you look at the projected expenses, we are currently anticipating, and it's still only half a year gone by, a surplus of $348,357. And I will send this out to everybody so you can take a closer look at it. And then if you had any questions, you certainly could either email me, ask me, but let me get that out to you. Okay, so that's it for me, unless anybody has any questions, Ian.
Diana Day has a question.
Let's see. Am I all set, Anne-Marie? You guys can hear me okay?
That's
okay.
Stilson.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, so I just wanted to touch base on the assessment conversation, and I know that we really can't do anything about some things, Anne-Marie and Dr. Baker, but the eighth graders and the fourth graders have more assessments than others. So for instance, my eighth graders, they have ExactPath. Then they did Track My Progress this year. And then they have the NAEP test coming on the 24th. Then they have the SBAC coming. Then they have the spring ExactPath. And then they're going to have the spring science assessment. Mm-hmm. So when you start talking about assessments, the eighth graders, for instance, have two more this year because they have NAEP and the science one.
Yeah.
So I know from dealing with them, you know, they kind of get worn out on the assessment department. So we can't do anything about the NAEP. We can't do anything about SBAC. I get that. But I just want to make you all aware of how it is for us. And the middle level, we're already worried about the spring, you know, because we're going to have ExactPath and SBAC and and everything. So that's all I wanted to say.
No, that's good feedback, Diane.
Yeah, I had heard similar from some other, not within our school, but from other schools in our district, that there's a little bit of testing fatigue going on.
Yeah, exactly.
And especially with the exact path, because each one of the assessments, it's math, reading, and ELA, we give 2 full days of a whole class period to do it. And all for my math class, it can take 2 full days of a period and sometimes win time. And I know Dr. Baker mentioned Angie's looking for feedback from the teachers and from students, but it's a time-consuming process versus Track My Progress is just one period. So when you have 3 subject areas, 3 contents, and you're doing, you know, that, January was a killer because the window didn't open until the 10th of January, and then it closed on the 31st. And then we had 1 day off, and then we had a half a day. So, you know, we did exact path each and every week in January because of the window.
Yeah.
So.
Well, that'll be good. That's why, too, they want to go around and, you know, just get that feedback because it's critical. But I understand. And I don't know why the state always picked 4-8, 4-8. They've been doing that for as long as I can remember. At one point, they did a 5th grade assessment, which helped out a little bit. But they love 4 and 8. Huh.
So, I mean, is there anything that we can do to lessen the amount of testing that's going on? Do we necessarily need to do Track My Progress if we're doing the exact path? Or?
Well, that's what we're thinking. I think we really, and I don't want to speak for Angie and Brittany, but I'm thinking once they get the feedback to, because we're still doing Track My Progress, correct? I mean, right, Angie?
Yeah. Yes, that's correct. So, yeah. I mean, I think the other thing that's contributed to this year, no doubt about it, we know that when we were continuing to use Track My Progress and ExactPath that we were doing double the testing. I think it also has felt like the testing just doesn't end because you have kids coming in and not here. And so you're like, oh, did that kid take that? Oh, where's that kid? So you have to keep track of all the students because they're coming in and out due to the COVID disruption. So I don't think that has helped either. One thing I do want to be really clear is that we're not tightening up our testing and data practices so that we can say that kids were supposed to be at a certain spot at a certain time. And I really want to make that clear that we recognize the challenges of teaching this year. And this is, I do agree. I think it's a little over the top. And I mean, it's become apparent to us. And I think we'll be having a very serious conversation about that as the data comes in. And I'm going to be reaching out to Weathersfield teachers who couldn't didn't have time today. We were in the school this morning, and so that we can go in and talk with their kids after break. But it's not our aim for our teachers to think that their children are behind in some awful way. So it's really so that we can meet kids where they're at and then support our teachers in supporting the kids where they're at.
Thanks, Angie. Does anyone else have any questions or comments for Dr. Baker? Becky?
Yeah, I just wanted to know if we're still are going to hire an equity and justice person for the SU. Is that something that's still being looked at, or is that something that all this work that's being done is going to be determined?
No, that's a great question, Becky. And, and the timing of that is important. But one of the things we just contracted with a woman by the name of Mary Gannon, the SU board did, and she's going to be working with the board on developing a job description for that job and looking at sort of an outline of you know, reporting status, who they report to, so I think the simple answer to your question is yes, we are eventually going to hire a DEI or diversity, equity, and inclusion coordinator, if that's the name we choose. But it's probably not going to be until next year, and it might be simultaneous with the equity audit. That's what we're hoping, because that would help that person prioritize where the work needs to be done. So stay tuned, but that's a good question.
Thanks.
Anyone have anything else? Okay, I guess we'll move on to items for discussion. And the first thing we have up is the annual school meeting presentation. Jackie, do you want to share where you're at with that?
Actually, BJ and I had a bit of a little back and forth email, and lead learner Martez is actually going to also present. So we said, why do two separate things? Let's combine the effort, because who wants to, you know, duplicate. And so today, Brian and I spoke, and he's going to do a little work on it. If I think it's next week that we'd like to talk with the board about it. Is that correct, Brian? We were thinking next week we would actually show more of the presentation. We can certainly talk about it tonight. And then probably follow up with one more sidebar meeting to see how we all feel about the combined effort. Have we met all of our targets for town meeting?
Okay.
Yeah. So if we could meet next week sometime, if that's okay.
Yeah, we could have a special meeting, Anne Marie. It'd just be a matter of getting everybody's schedule, as long as people are going to be around.
Yeah. Does anyone have anything in particular that would be a bad night for them?
I can't do Monday night, but I can do any other night. Jamie Turner just raised her hand too, Anne Marie.
Jamie?
I can't do Wednesday.
Okay. So Wednesday and Monday are out.
How about Tuesday?
People think about next Tuesday.
Tuesday looks good.
And that would give you guys enough time to get ready?
Yeah, we should be able to have a good draft by then to be able to take a look at it. We're going to spice it up a little bit.
Yeah, Brian's going to, you know, he's going to kick the can down the road and kick it up a notch, so, or 10. And yeah. I think that's fantastic, so.
Yeah.
Now that's great. So we'll just warn it as a special meeting.
Yeah.
To discuss the town.
Can we do it a little later? 6 o'clock. I mean, I know we like to try to get out of here at a decent hour, so we have it at 6. But if it's going to be a shorter meeting, do you think like 6:30 or 7 would be okay?
6:30 would be better for me.
6:30? Okay. So let's say next Tuesday at 6:30, a special meeting.
Is that virtual or in person?
I think virtual, right? Yeah.
I don't mind either way. It's really what other people would like to do.
That's fine. If it's a special meeting, I presume it has to be recorded.
Yeah.
As well. So as long as one of you can record it, that'd be great.
Yep. Okay. That sounds good. Do we have like all the numbers that we need from Ed, or do we have any questions for Ed for what we're going to present? I guess I was kind of wondering like if anything had changed, like where we're at with the actual tax decrease, if the percentage of that is still the same as what we discussed last month, or if it's changed.
I'll make sure I get all the correct information or the current information and have that ready to be able to plug in there.
Okay. So you have a copy of what we presented last year, right? So you know kind of the information we need to have in there?
Yep.
As far as that goes? Okay. Great. Okay. Well, that's perfect. We'll talk about that next week then. So we'll move on. I sort of wanted to kind of before the end of people's terms and stuff, just kind of review the radar list and just see where we're at. I think we're doing pretty well. I know that Brian has really been on top of a lot of these things. The teacher and staff recognition, I know that you've been giving them some breaks here and there and some goodie swag bags and stuff like that. So
that's good. And then the Friday the 25th that we have for the early release day, we are doing a luncheon as well for all the staff.
Nice.
To be able to help give them something back and just have an opportunity for us to break bread as a family. And be able to, because although we've been cutting back on meetings and trying to take stuff off their plate, it's also hasn't given us that opportunity to be together as a group and to really get to know each other a little bit more. So I think that's important for us to have that opportunity together.
Great. And then the school and the town working together, that's been going really well as well. Do you know what's happening as far as the town meeting goes? Are they going to be sending something out with our information in it for when our thing is, or what's happening with that? Like
BJ, you might have the best updated information. I mean, is that they're going to send out a report, an annual report, right?
Yes, town report is being printed as we speak.
No, not the town report, but like last year they sent out like a postcard that like included like our Google meeting link. Are they doing that again?
Brandon and I had a quick conversation with that, and I said, oh, we're meeting hybrid. He goes, you are? Does the select board know that? And I said, I'm not sure. So he said, I'll call you back, and I really didn't hear back from him to say about the postcard. So my main focus on the snow day of Friday was getting the final touches on the town report, and so that's to the printers, and it's a print now for that. It should be just about done.
Okay.
And I'll contact Brandon tomorrow and I'll see just to make sure to touch base with him.
Great. Thanks, BJ.
Yep.
Next thing on the radar list was the middle school model. And we heard about the work that Mr. Vila and Mr. Santangelo and others are doing to make our middle school more exciting for the kids. And everything sounds very good to me. Does anyone else have any comments on that?
I would just agree to that. It sounds like things are moving ahead very well. I love it.
How is the makerspace coming along, Brian? Are you gathering materials for that or what's?
We're slowly starting to gather materials. I'm we're setting up a meeting for Hicks Nichols to be able to meet as well. Tara Smith, our librarian, who's going to be simultaneously running the makerspace with her current role, is she came up with a proposal to present to them, so we're trying to figure out a time that we can meet with them to go over some of the materials that we would like for it. And then we're looking at the space that we currently have, which is our computer lab, and starting to clean that out and see what items that we can still use that we have in there instead of trying to reinvent the whole wheel, but make it snazzy at the same time when we do it. So
okay. I know that the whole SU has been working really hard on the mental health help for the students. We also have on there a health class. Is there anything happening with that or any proposals in the works? I know there was a thought to maybe share a health teacher amongst the SU.
Yeah, we did. You know, the simple answer is no. You know, we haven't made any progress on it, but that might be something to continue to bring up at the SU meeting and just, you know, get it back on the radar a little bit, because that was the thought. But no, not recently.
Yeah. Foreign language, I know we've put that in the budget for next year. So do you know, like, I guess you probably don't start looking for teachers just yet, huh?
Actually, we have started to look for teachers as an anticipated opening, waiting to make sure that our budget passes and that we have the funding source for that. But we actually have put that out in school spring and we've got a candidate. So we don't know yet, but we'll see. So that's pretty exciting. And then we also did anticipate an opening for an elementary school teacher as well. And we've got a couple candidates. We are getting people from all over the world. I'll just say that.
Wow. Very interesting.
Not just from California, huh?
No. No, we're from the West Coast. That's This is going to be the international melting pot right here. And I like that.
And last thing on the radar list, I think, maybe there's, yeah, is community outreach. And I know that Brian and BJ and the school, they've really been working on that. So that's also, I think, been going really well.
I agree with that. Thank you, Anne-Marie. And I forgot to mention with the vaccination clinic, I forgot to thank BJ. BJ is my right-hand person. She's amazing. You guys know that. We all know that. That was an easy one. But she always goes above and beyond, including feeding all of the volunteers that were there. She made chili, which was pretty amazing chili. She added a little bit of chorizo for me to make it a little spicy, brought me back to California a little bit. So I appreciated that, but she was there and just supported it as much. And then of course her husband, John, as well, because you know, when you are the spouse of an educator, your spouse is involved just as much as you are. So thank you again, BJ. I appreciate all your support.
Thank you, BJ. Okay. Up next would be our athletics update.
All right, so Jessica couldn't be here because we did have a 3-4 basketball game, home game. Kristen, how did they do? I see that you're on there now.
We lost by 2, but it was.
Oh, this is your option year, Kristen.
And we were co-ed and they were all boys, so you know, it was yeah, awesome. Nice. Yeah.
Good though. Good job. That's I look forward great. To seeing them in action. So
yeah.
So I do have her athletic update. So like I mentioned before, we have 2 spectators that are now permitted for athlete at home events for home and away teams for basketball. Basketball will continue for a few weeks after February break due to the late start. And basketball has a total of 57 participants this year. And then spring softball, baseball track registrations will open the end of February, early March, and aim for an April start pending weather. And that's her update for today.
Great.
And Anne-Marie, that reminds me, we might, not so much on our special meeting next week, but we might want to put spring sports on the agenda. I mean, I think people, mm-hmm. It wasn't that long ago, it got a little controversial. So just to kind of, maybe by then, Jessica, by our reorganization meeting in March, Jessica could have, you know, some numbers, some preliminary numbers, so we can have an idea of how we want to go.
Mm-hmm. Great. Yeah,
I think and I know you want to talk about theater, but you're going to do that in a minute, right?
Yeah, up next. Yeah, actually, that's next is talking about the. I know we had budgeted some money for a theater program, and it has not been happening for the past couple of years because of COVID. It was recently an email sent out regarding Heartland having a musical. And requesting that if Weathersfield students wanted to participate, they could. Some people were just feeling like, how can Heartland have it and Weathersfield not? What's the difference there as far as why are we restricted from having the program if other schools can within our SU? So I just was wanting to get, an answer to that for them?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. And quite frankly, nobody would be restricted. I think the reason Heartland is doing it is because they've had a 24-year veteran, right, champion of musicals. They do it every year. Mm-hmm. And they always invite schools that potentially might not have a program. And I don't know, I haven't talked to Brian about this, or the board hasn't really talked about it. But there would be nothing stopping you this year. I mean, I think that's one of the loosening of restrictions that we could have. If we did it somewhat for sports, I think we can do it for theater, right? That we can, you know, mix pods, and do that. I just don't know, you know, what is the condition right now of somebody to really organize that and bulldog that project.
Okay. I see Mark's hand up.
Brian, did you get a chance to glance over my proposal that I sent to you and the other board members?
Yes, I did look at it today. I think there's some great ideas. If you would like to share that, that would be amazing.
Okay. I'm sorry, David. I'm guessing this didn't get forwarded to you. I should have kept you in the loop there too.
That's okay.
For me personally, I'm primarily concerned about the learning loss in terms of the institution itself. It's hard enough to mount any kind of large scale production or musical. And I shudder to think about what it would be like to attempt to do so next year, having 3 full years off with no live performance of any of the existing student body. Jackie's kids were a part of spurring on the younger classes. Laura Powers' kids were part of spurring on the younger kids. Eric and I did, I remember doing at least 5. I don't know how many Erica did as well. But we don't have an option right now as far as how the day is structured and COVID restrictions. I think it'd be a terrible idea to try and mount a large scale production. But I really want to have the kids get their feet wet and get them excited about next year and this year. And we've got kids that have been waiting now for 2 full years saying, okay, maybe I'll get my chance. Maybe I'll be able to show what I can do. And it's, we did a lot to accommodate sports. And now we're finally reaping the benefits of it. It's only 2 members of the family, but they're there and present. So what my suggestion was is that we used to do a Weathersfield's Got Talent as a kind of a bonanza and an all-purpose talent show. We had an MC, but that model really requires a massive crowd. And a big mixed thing. So my suggestion was we do more of a cabaret format, not as far as the cabaret, the racy musical, but a cabaret in small acts. You get 1 or 2 or 3 people that are already in a pod together to audition and work on that audition process, work on that rehearsal process, and then bring them in a very structured small environment where we cycle through acts and cycle through audience members, so that if you have 2 or 4 or 6 family members allowed for the performance, you bring them in rotation, and maybe you have several of these audience pods at the same time, and you cycle through the performers and their associated audience. And that, so that brings us a little bit back to the community format. And it gets some of this base knowledge back into the heads of the kids. Because if you turn around and have 50 kids trying to perform in a production and nobody knows basic stage direction, you're basically teaching language skills at that point. If you've got everybody who's never been on stage before, you're really starting at ground zero, and it's essentially mission impossible, especially when you've got a bunch of middle schoolers. So I don't know who else would be willing to, but I am crazy enough to offer, if I'm allowed in the school, to be a participant in this. I'd be happy to go over some audition practice with students that are interested. And then at the direction of Brian, and certainly BJ as well, as far as how the space can be used. I know it's not going to be the kind of thing where we can have a teacher jump in right after school and help out like we used to. We've got the learning loss is already being addressed by the teachers immediately after school through the collaborative time. But if there's any, I'd love any other ideas that anybody thinks how we could structure this. But I'd like it to be a small contained compartmentalized production that we cycle through. And I'd like it to be at a time that doesn't interfere with SBACs and all of these other testing that have to happen. And I don't want to put, I don't want to put any extra pressure on the staff. I would welcome anybody else's participation and certainly expertise, but I don't want to put that as one more thing on top of all the testing and everything else. So if anybody's got any other ideas, please share them with Brian and myself.
Thank you, Mark. And thank you for volunteering to help with this project. One thing I was thinking is, since we're coming up on nicer weather, would it be possible to do an outdoor performance?
I'm all for that, especially if it's at the end. As far as May, I don't know. When do we have dates already for SBACs and when they're wrapping up, Brian?
Yeah, we're doing our testing is the first 2 weeks in May.
Well, so I'd want to schedule this in a way that it doesn't interfere with graduation. And, you know, so it's basically sneaking in between SBACs and commencement.
BJ, would it be possible to put something maybe in the next newsletter requesting if there are any parents that have a little theatrical experience or desire to help out?
And that's, I'm sorry, that one, I want to throw this out there. Brian, how can we do this as far as what do we need as far as volunteers? If we're asking for volunteers that are parents, what do we need in order to actually allow them into the building as far as the stipulations we have now?
Well, I believe they would have to be vaccinated. And then we'd have to allow certain volunteers in during those times that we're auditioning and rehearsing. So we'd have to look at that exact schedule and then try to have those volunteers be with, you know, those specific pods of people. So we'd have to be strategic in planning it, but I think it can be done.
Okay. Jackie, you have your hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to say thank you, Mark, for jumping in and offering to help out. And you bring up some very valid points. I also thought that I was thinking the same thing, Anne-Marie, as far as being outside, even if we needed to rent a tent so that we didn't have to worry about weather. But I do think that maybe can't we intermix a talent show with the monologues and the theatrical piece, because I do feel that that does include more children. And since like you're talking about doing a theater piece and cycling through a certain number of audience members, and we could do the same for another act, right? For another talent show. I think it shouldn't just be for monologues and small theater pieces. A lot of those, you know, from seeing the talent shows, a lot of those were, you know, a few kids or a couple of kids or one kid up on stage. So it just feels like that would be a better thing.
Yeah, just to clarify, I did say in the proposal that we are looking for small acts, spoken word pieces, dance, instrument performance. So it is varied. I didn't want it to just be, you know, recitation of Shakespeare or, you know, any small pieces like that. I just, in the past when we've done things like the talent show, it was the atmosphere of that entire production that I can't see how we work that into this current environment. But no, I proposed musical performance and all the rest of that as well.
I just think if it's outside, I think it does allow us to have a larger crowd. Just because, I mean, look at the graduations and such that took place during COVID, even that were outdoors. So, you know, I'd be I'd be willing to help out some with the creativity of any of that planning if you want. You know, unfortunately, I won't be able to be at the school before 4:30 in the afternoon to help out with anything. So just let me know.
Thanks, Jackie. Brian, you have your hand up.
Yeah, so I think, especially if we did it outside, the sky could literally be the limit, pardon the pun. But I think also if we did, you know, we could still cycle through with the talent show type of aspect where we still had small groups. You know, the first group would come in and do it just like Mark was saying. I think we could open that up. And then the nice thing about that too is then we can open it up for students. Or if somebody has a little bit of stage fright, but they have a talent that they want to share, then it can be, you know, like if they're a great snowboarder, they can be filmed snowboarding and bring in that digital piece as well, so that we have the whole gamut of different things for students to be able to show their talents or show their skills, whether it's on stage or a performance of a different type that's pre-recorded, and still parents could cycle through and watch it and see. So I think we've got some amazing ideas, and I think we can do this.
Great. Awesome. Does anyone else have anything to add to this topic? No? Okay. Well, I'll leave it up to you guys to work that all out. And we'll move on to items for action. And we have a request from the parent teacher organization for a fundraiser. Is Carrie here? Yeah, she's there. Carrie, do you want to give a brief little spiel?
Sure. Thank you. So the PTO last fall had asked permission to do the car show was one thing, which ended up getting postponed and then not happening. And an online fundraiser, which we did, was very successful, brought in over $800. And then some sort of raffle in the spring, and our apparel order we did very well on as well. So we're coming back around with the raffle, which would be what we are calling a March Madness calendar. 31 days of prizes, $10 per calendar. So if someone pays $10, they get 31 chances to win. So March 1st, we pick a winner. And if that's Brian, his name goes back in and has a chance to win all the other days as well. All of the prizes that we have a minimum value of $20, upwards of $50 to $75. It's a lot of cash, a lot of gift cards. And then our final prize on March 31st is $250 cash. So the $10 chances really goes directly into the PTO funds and enables us to give back to the school community. You know, we had a quick text exchange when Mr. Vila was talking about the t-shirts and how if there's a way we could help support that project for them. We got a $1,000 grant from Claremont Savings Bank specifically earmarked to give mini grants to staff and projects at school and teachers. So we have money to give back that way. So we're just really hoping to get final approval on this specific calendar fundraiser so that we can move forward and sell tickets, and the drawings would happen the month of March.
Great. And I did do a little bit of research on this, and David helped me out by contacting our SU attorney, and it appears that the raffle would be legal as it's for a nonprofit. You can have gambling to a certain extent, and we are below those limits, so that's good. So I will take a motion to approve the request by the PTO to hold a calendar raffle in the month of March.
So moved.
Okay, do I have a second?
I'll second. It's Kristen.
Kristen seconds. I'll go do a roll call for this. We'll start off with Jamie.
Aye.
Jackie.
Aye.
Mark.
Aye.
Kristen.
Aye.
And aye for me as well. So that's unanimous.
Thank you.
You guys have great success.
Thank you very much. We'll be coming after you to sell tickets.
Yep.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Up next is setting the next agenda, and that will be our March meeting, which we will have at least one new school board member, I think. So we need to sort of do like a reorganization and that sort of thing. Elect chair, vice chair, secretary, and our SU representatives. So that'll be the part of the beginning of the meeting next time. And then we also wanted to have on their spring sports to make sure that we are, taking into consideration some of the community feedback we got from last spring. And let's see, what else? Town meeting will be over, so we won't have that. Hopefully. I mean, I guess maybe, I don't know, should we put something on there, David, like in case the budget goes down? I don't know. Or that could just be added.
Yeah, I think that could just be added. I wouldn't worry about that.
Okay. I guess we could see where we're at with the plans for the spring production. What's happening with that? BJ?
I have an answer for Brandon, so when you're done with this, so just call me back, because I have an answer. Text Brandon about the postcard.
Okay.
Thanks.
Jackie?
I think we're going to have as a placeholder to see if the eighth graders are ready to present again.
Oh, that's right. The eighth graders we're going to present again. Yep. Well, that's part of the lead learner report, but we can put it on the actual, we'll stick it there underneath lead learner report. The eighth grade business plans. And we can do some advertising for them. Okay. Do we need an executive session for any reason? No? Oh, we didn't set the date and the time for next meeting.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Sorry.
Well, we could do that on Wednesday, actually, if you wanted to. I mean, Tuesday, rather. We're meeting next week, right?
Oh, yeah. Well, I don't know. Let's get it in our calendars now. It's would be March 8th is what it typically would be, unless somebody has a problem with it.
Hold on, let me just take a quick peek. No, that works. That work for everybody?
At 6 p.m. for that one.
That works for me, and Becky has her hand up.
Becky?
Oh, I actually just wanted to go back and ask about the special meeting next Tuesday.
Yeah.
I didn't hear the time.
6:30.
Okay, I knew you said something different. Okay,
yeah, I think I invited you back. Yeah, 6:30.
Okay, and I should probably come and take notes for that.
If you're available, if you're not, it'll be a short meeting. Okay. Maybe.
No, I should be.
You are? Okay, great. Thanks, Becky. We appreciate your volunteering your time for us. So.
Don't miss our party, Becky. Don't miss it.
What's the party? Oh, next week?
Okay, so March 8th at 6 p.m. is our regularly scheduled meeting. Okay. Does anyone have anything else? Oh, BJ, you were going to tell us about Brandon.
Yeah, I sent him a quick email. And I said, is the town sending out a postcard announcing the town meeting? And he says, yes, but it's only specific to the town's annual meeting since we're doing different things this year, which means they're virtual only and we're hybrid. So I'm thinking that's what it is.
Okay. So do we need to send out our own postcard then, or do we just post that our meeting, just post it online and it's in the town report? Is that enough?
Yeah, I think if you get it on, you get the link on the Facebook page and on
yeah,
you know, the list, the listserv of Front Porch Forum, however Wethersfield works. I've been doing it in the email blast, so it certainly gets out to parents. I don't think you need to do a postcard unless the board feels strongly.
Jackie?
Is that something that they'll put in the newspaper for us for free?
They should.
I could have Lori check.
Yeah, if you could, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, I'll email her right now.
Okay. Mark?
Did this go up on the town website?
The town report is it's gonna be in the town report, you know, it's on our warrant, all the meeting notices and stuff like that. So when that goes on the web pages, like it'll go on ours, the town report and everything. So yes, Mark, the short answer is yes. But it's kind of like with the town report, which is virtual. We can put out an announcement on the school website, mm-hmm. you know, and announce it that way. And then just keep sharing that document to say, mm-hmm. you know, social media is our friend.
Yep.
So long as it's warned, right?
That it will be warned.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I guess if no one has anything else, I'll take a motion to adjourn.
Palmer, motion that we adjourn at 7:38 p.m.
Well done.
Second. Mark seconds that, and all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Okay, thanks everybody.
Have a great night.
Thank you.
Take care. Have a great night.
Have a good vacation. Yep. See you Wednesday.